Star Citizen on a gaming laptop. Can it be done? Well, it can be. I've looked at this in the past on a pretty cheap gaming laptop, but this time Black Friday has come along and I picked up a gaming laptop for £600. It's got a 4050, pretty low-end GPU for a laptop. It's got 16 gigabytes of DDR5 running at 5600 megatransfers, and the processor, which is obviously the key part of performance in Star Citizen, is a Ryzen 5 7640HS. It's got 6 cores, 12 threads, and it's pretty decent. It doesn't draw much power. It's not a really high-end gaming CPU, but it's pretty good. So we're going to put this up, this laptop, up against my main system with a 7800X3D and 4080, and my minimum spec system, which has currently got an i5-10400 in with a 1660. We're going to compare those three systems, and we're going to see how does this laptop perform. Is it actually quite good value? First up, let's get into the city's Area 18. Now, this result isn't bad. That laptop there that you can see, the 4050, it's pretty playable. I'll put some footage up on screen as well that kind of just shows you the run as it's in progress. This is pretty decent. We are CPU bound here, so the 4050, despite being a really low-end GPU for a laptop, is actually not being particularly pushed very hard here at all, and that is quite consistent throughout this. As we'd expect with Star Citizen, the CPU is the major factor, and so we are CPU bound in most of the scenes we're going to see, maybe a couple towards the end that maybe we won't be, but it's pretty decent performance. One thing we should mention at this stage is that this thing is loud. Gaming laptops are loud. The fans really were, and you're going to have to wear some sort of headphones if you're using one of these things. Into Lorville, where I do the massive load of runs and runs and runs to get a good average, you'll see here that performance is pretty good. We are beating out the minimum spec system, and actually, even though we've got the 16 gigabytes of RAM, which lots of people will say, oh, is the minimum is 32, I don't agree with that really, but it is playable with 16, and in this case, we weren't getting massive amounts of kind of spikes, and the 1% percentile lows are not great there, but it does feel significantly smoother than the minimum spec system. And overall, you probably don't want to be in the cities for too long anyway, but it was fine to get around. It was pretty good. Next up, this scene that I kind of call the Orizon render thread test. This is a scene that you look out across the city and you are CPU bound. All of these results are CPU bound. You'll see again, it's significantly better than the 10400, even though obviously this is a power limited part. With laptop parts, power is the main issue. And even though this can't draw as much power as the i5 there, it's much more efficient now. It's a newer CPU from AMD here, so it's actually doing pretty well here. Again, on the Orizon roof, we are CPU bound on all of these results. The laptop is again outperforming the 10400 pretty handily, and it just again shows that in these sorts of scenes where you're CPU bound, you are outperforming desktop parts from not that long ago. So it is pretty good and quite impressive. Let's take a quick look at the cloud settings. So here we've got high, medium, very high clouds. And as we know, even at 1080p, very high clouds is really demanding. So the very high clouds is actually GPU limited. The other two are still CPU limited, but it's going to be interesting with the clouds as 3.22 comes along, and CIG in theory are going to change quite a lot to see whether things do improve. But for now, stick your clouds on medium and I think forget about it. Out in space, there's not a whole heap going on, but some quite interesting results here. The minimum spec system is just ahead here, and it's actually GPU bound. So for some reason, the 10400 in that system is able to stretch its legs a bit more. And for the laptop, we are actually still CPU bound here. So for some reason, the 10400 is a little bit ahead here of the Ryzen 5 7640HS. In Quantum Travel, we are finally GPU bound. So you'll see that the laptop, the 4050, is doing pretty well here. The 4080 is actually still not the bottleneck for the main system. That's still on the CPU, the 7800X3D. But for the minimum spec system and the laptop, we are GPU bound. And you'll see that the 4050 is quite a significant chunk ahead of the 1660. Again, despite being limited, from what I can tell, to about 90 watts of power. Now, one of the confusing things with laptops is that it is a minefield in terms of GPUs, what they actually draw power-wise. So you can have two laptops might look exactly the same, but because of the power that the parts are allowed to draw, they might perform very differently. But actually, for this one, drawing around 90 watts is pretty good and pretty close to the max that you'd really want from this thing. So again, it's drawing less, a lot less power than the 1660, but performing better. Let's have a quick look at a bunker mission. So we're on a planet in a bunker. There's not a whole heap going on for the CPU to do. So we actually allow our GPU to stretch its legs. And you'll see here some pretty decent performance. We're kind of around the 60 FPS mark on the GPU. We're kind of GPU bottlenecked here. And that's decent. At 1080p, I don't think you can complain at all about that. And so if you are looking to buy a laptop, it's questionable whether you should really go much higher than the 4050 for a GPU at 1080p. If you were at 1440p, obviously changes the story, but at 1080p on a 16-inch screen, I'm not sure there's much point getting 1440p on a 16-inch screen. This setup is kind of perfect for this sort of mission. The GPU isn't a problem whatsoever, and this is very playable. It was very playable apart from the fact that half of the enemies were not there or in the floor, who knows, but that's Star Citizen for you. Next up, a bounty hunter mission. You'll see here that actually we're mostly CPU bound still here, and we're kind of in the 40s for an FPS. So this isn't what you would describe as really smooth, but it's completely playable and very, very usable. And so I think we have to conclude with this, that for £600, obviously it's a Black Friday deal, but there are these sorts of laptops around and available at this sort of price. This is very impressive. It's much better, I would say, in terms of smoothness, and that it's a fair chunk ahead often of the minimum spec system that I have, that I recommend as the kind of bare minimum to get in the game around the 30 FPS mark. So this is much better than that. And if you have to buy a gaming laptop, which is worth saying, I think if you've got the choice, I think most people are choosing to build a desktop and you're not worrying about power, I think generally that's best for most people. But there are cases for people who need a laptop or need to be able to travel or would like the ability to take their gaming experience to a friend's house or something like that. And so if you are looking to buy a gaming laptop, the top tips really have got to be prioritize that CPU. It is the most important part for Star Citizen, as it always has been. Even with a low-end GPU, that wasn't a problem here, the 4050, and 16 gigabytes of RAM didn't really make too much of a problem here, wasn't an issue, but that CPU was the bottleneck. So the faster the CPU you can get, the better it will perform, and the closer you'll get to desktop sort of performance. But do keep an eye on the power draw of these parts, because like we said, the GPU can vary, even if it's a 4050 in one and a 4050 in another. Depending on how much power it will draw will depend on how well it performs. So it is a minefield. Do your research, watch some good YouTube videos.